So this case, Milin, that we're going to do, can you describe what this case is? And I hope a number of things that Omkar highlighted are going to get illustrated via that case that we're going to do.
Yeah, sure. So let me just start sharing my screen, Jay. So this case is about a fictitious e-commerce company called FabMart. So FabMart is a global company and has recently entered India, largely focused on the South Indian market, right? So right now, given where demographic trends are and so on, they've decided to concentrate on South of India, but they definitely plan to expand in other parts of India. Intention is to offer some of the best brands to the customers and best-in-class service, both before and after purchase. So this is the sort of value proposition of the company. And Omkar is going to represent this company in our conversation today, right?
Okay.
So he's going to tell us what are some of the problems that people within the company have faced and what kind of challenges, what kind of data challenges. So before we get into the case, Omkar, a company like this that is handling multiple kinds of goods, right? So it could be selling mobile phones, it could be selling maybe some oil, some FMCG, some soap. They could also be selling clothes. So very, very different sorts of goods are being sold. So what kind of distribution challenges and what kind of data challenges do you think we are going to see today?
Okay, so we will be focusing on the supply chain and distribution network on customer side in the case today. In e-commerce, the problem that we have is a lot of data, right? We have lots and lots of data coming every single minute for every customer, for every purchase, for every page view that a customer is doing, right? Of the matter is how do we get story out of that? How do we understand the data patterns and how do we build our actions around what is required, which is coming out of the data? You will see a lot of times there are some structures which are put in place, which are typically supply chain structures, which actually make analyzing a little bit difficult. We'll have a flavor of that today, where there will be a single tier structure, two tier structure of distribution. We'll talk about that. The second thing is there will be some inventory, there will be some sale which is happening. The supply chain is worried about how do I maintain the stock at right levels so that the customers will never face stock-up, right? Because this is a very competitive world. If I don't have something in stock, I'm sure there are plenty of other options available in the market, right? So the customer is just going to switch, and losing customer is going to cost me a lot. So I don't want to do that at any cost. Third thing is I want to operate at an efficient level because I'm in the business of making money at the end of the day, right? So I don't want to just build inefficiencies, build piles of stocks and make it inefficient for my investors and my own company because I need that cash flow for making sure I grow at a decent and faster rate, which is good enough for my investors to keep pumping money or putting faith in me for my future growth plans. So this is a landscape that we are trying to look at today. And the example, as Milin was saying, is a platform company that we typically talk about, which is not specialized only in one particular vertical. There are e-commerce companies who specialize only in a particular vertical, right? There are companies who specialize in clothing. There are companies who are specialized in let's say cosmetics, right? Happens is their supply chains become relatively simple as compared to a platform company, right? Because if I'm dealing with one kind of product, I know what is.
Omkar, just so that for our students,
yeah,
you keep using this word platform.
Yes.
Explain what you mean by platform company.
Yeah. So when I'm talking about platform company, the company that we have here is FabMart, right? So FabMart has different service offerings. It is offering a range of goods. For sake of simplicity, for sake of discussion of this case, what we have done is we have taken three representatives. One is lifestyle, which is your clothes, men's and women's clothing. The second is FMCG, which is nothing but your soap, shampoos, and beauty and grooming kits and lipsticks and all that stuff. And third is a relatively niche category, which is mobile phones, which is actually one of the first entrants into this e-commerce. So there are three different categories that we are representing. You might have seen Flipkart. We deal with, I think, complete range of product offerings. We deal with something as big as a multi-door refrigerator to as simple thing as a stationery kit or needles or safety pins, stuff like that. So we offer a complete range of products on our platform, right? We have fruits and vegetables. We have faster service deliveries. We have we deal in books. We deal in media. So there is a complete offering which we have. So this is what makes a company as a platform company. And when I'm talking about niche company will have only one service offering, right? They will be dealing only in, let's say, cosmetics. You'll know a lot of names which are there in cosmetics, right? There will be a lot of companies who are dealing only in say, lifestyle products. We have a sister company called Myntra. You would have heard about that. They used to focus only on high-end clothing, right? So these are the niche companies. From supply chain perspective, what I was coming up with is for niche companies, it is relatively easy to develop supply chains because it's a homogeneous product which is going to flow. However, when it comes to a platform company, it becomes a little tricky and a little difficult because there are different kinds of products altogether, right? Some will need speed. For example, someone is buying an Apple mobile phone, right, in Chennai. That person is not going to wait for 2 days or 3 days for that phone to be delivered, right? Mm. That person has an option to go out and walk into Apple store and buy the phone. Why am I buying it from an e-commerce company? If I don't get it on time, that customer will be lost, right? So there is one category which needs speed. There is other category like lifestyle. When I'm buying clothes for sake of it, right? It's not like I need something. I am not going to a platform to buy clothes where I am running out of clothes, right? So it's a indulgence typically. So I don't mind waiting for products. So that is what FabMart is going to show you. So in FabMart, we, as I said, we have multiple brands and multiple service offerings. So typically we have four mobile brands, then there are three FMCG brands and two lifestyle brands. This is the data and this is the product mix that you'll see. Each brand has a different price point and it has a different value proposition. So for example, a Real You brand in mobiles is an aspirational entry brand, which are cheaper mobile phones, which is meant for, let's say, professionals who have just started working or college students or maybe the kids who wanted to go online for their classes now for online education, right? Whereas there is a brand Orange, which is premium brand, which is for working professionals, the CXOs of the companies, and all they will probably find it difficult to get something apart from this, right? So there is a range of service offerings, there are a range of products, and there are a range of brands, and each and every one will behave differently, right? Each and every of these brands will have a different expectation from customer. There will be SKUs within these brands, we'll talk about that. There are different price points and there are different sale rates, DRRs, daily run rate that we talk about, which make it more difficult for a platform to organize the whole supply chain. The main problem is how is the best way to, let's say, deploy a particular inventory? How much inventory I should keep for each one of them? These are the questions that we'll talk about and we'll try to find out.
So, though there are four brands, so that represents, that kind of targets four different consumer segments, I suppose, so in terms of income profile or whether they're young, old, all that. But all these four mobile brands, they will all want their phones quickly. I mean, you said Apple, people won't wait for more than 2 days, but that's true for mobiles in general, right?
Absolutely, because mobiles is a high, intensity purchase. A customer will not buy mobiles in a shot, right? I go to a, let's say, a mall, right? I like a shirt, I'll buy it. I'll not think twice.
Mm-hmm.
like that. Mobiles is something that I'll probably think about. I want to buy something. I'll search for that brand. I'll search for reviews. I'll talk to people who are using that. And then only I'll make up my mind to get into this. But when I make up my mind, when I commit, it's a high cost purchase, right? So when I commit myself on buying a particular brand of mobile, a particular model of a mobile, I want it right then and there.
Okay, understand.
Yeah.
Shall I go to the next slide, Omkar?
Yes, please. All right. So now coming to the distribution network, right? We talked about this FabMart being a company which is focused on South India right now. Definitely, there are plans for pan-India expansion and maybe expansion beyond India as well. But it all needs money, right? So right now, what FabMart is doing is going to focus only on the South geography. And to start with, they have opened 3 distribution centers, right? Fulfillment center, distribution centers are the terminologies which are interchangeably used in this context. But what we have here is a typical 2-tier network of distribution, right? Hyderabad is the mother DC. Hyderabad is a buying point. It's a sourcing point. And then there are 2 child DCs or forward DCs, as we call it. One in Chennai and one in Kochi.
So okay. DC is a distribution center.
Distribution center. Yeah. For sake of simplicity, let's call Chennai as Madras M and Cochin as C and Hyderabad as H, right? That is the terminology you'll see in all the data and all. Now, the question will be, why do we need 3 distribution centers? And why not only 1 distribution center? The answer is very simple. Since the customer wants speed, I need to be as close to the customer as possible, right? So I am trying to serve 3 states here, rather 4 states here. Hyderabad will be serving the north part of South India. For Kerala and Tamil Nadu, there are specific customer requirements for speed, which will be addressed only when we have a Madras and Cochin as a distribution center or as a stocking point, right? Hyderabad may not be able to serve because Hyderabad to Chennai or Hyderabad to Cochin itself will take, I don't know, 1 day of transit time after order is placed, right? So to ensure that the customers in these 2 geographies get better speed, we need the server. We need fulfillment centers there or DCs there, right? But the problem is opening multiple DCs.
Just so that I understand a little better. So if yeah. I am a customer living in Tirunelveli,
yeah,
and I order a phone,
yes,
from where? How will the phone come to me?
I'll come to that. So. Very good question. So typically what we have is we have something called promise engine, right? For each PIN code where a customer belongs to, every single DC out of this will be mapped, right? Typically what we do in 2-tier network is there will be some catchment area which is attached to Madras and there will be some catchment area which is attached to Cochin, right? But the backup will be given in Hyderabad, right? So a PIN code of Tirunelveli will be attached to, for example, Chennai or Cochin, based on which of these 2 will be able to offer best possible speed for the customer.
Nice.
It's all about speed, right? Even if the speed is not expecting speed, since I'm also selling mobiles, I need to gear myself up for speed, right? That will be the first FC. So say that customer is linked to Madras FC. Okay, but Madras FC may not have all the assortment that we are going to sell. So what we will have is we will have a backup FC which goes up into Madar FC. In this case, it's Hyderabad. All right.
Okay.
So in case the product is not available in Madras in M, the product will be delivered from H. Yes, at a slow speed, but the product will be offered to the customer. That's the idea.
Thanks. Okay.
Now,
the customer, when the time of ordering, customer will know the speed, I mean, presumably, right?
Yes, the customer gets a promise if you, when you are ordering, when you put in PIN code, right? As soon as you put the PIN code, the system at backend will check where is the inventory for that product. And basis that it will promise it the delivery within 2 to 3 days or 1 to 2 days or tomorrow It will, based on the inventory, it will give a promise.
Okay.
Yeah.
I see. So that is why sometimes I see, you know, a book is going to be delivered in 2 days and sometimes it takes 10 days. Okay.
Yes. I understand. Books is a very little bit tricky category as well. So there are books which are actually printed on order.
I see. So,
in that case, you can expect things like 10 days.
I see.
Now with this advancement of technology, right? Earlier, they have a minimum order quantity of, let's say, 1,000, 10,000 copies of each book, right? But now, it's much easier.
Very nice. Understood. Yeah. It's an insight.
Yeah. Now, on this topic of MOQ, right? A minimum order quantity. So this MOQ is the one which actually mandates this two-tier network, right?
Cool.
Now, if I want to buy, let's say, all the in all of these three FCs, Hyderabad, Madras, and Cochin, what will happen is my MOQs will make my inventory bloat, right? Let's say MOQ for a particular SKU is 100 units. Yeah. And I need 30 units in three FCs.
So MOQ is minimum order quantity.
Minimum order quantity, yes.
And that who gives that quantity?
That is dictated by the suppliers.
Ah, okay.
So typically, in case of FMCG, it will be a box.
Okay.
Yeah. For mobiles, typically there is no MOQ, minimum order quantity, because it's a high value item. I cannot ask anyone to buy 10 mobiles at one point. Okay. For high value items, typically MOQs are not there, but for smaller value items, there will be MOQs, right? Again, coming back to example, let's say I need 30 units in all three FCs, and my box size in this case, MOQ, which we are talking about, is 100 units. If I want to buy in all three locations, I'll have to buy 100, 100, 100, 300 units in general, right? Which is a typical bloat of inventory. Whereas I'm buying only in Hyderabad, what I'll do is I'll buy 100 units in Hyderabad and distribute 60 units between Madras and Chennai and keep remaining 40 units for own consumption, right? So to keep the inventory in control, especially in the starting phase of your venture, when the economies of scale are still not kicking in, typically we look at this two-tier network.
Understood.
Even if you mature, right? Even when you mature, if you want to control the inventory, it's not like you have infinite money at the end of the day, right? So to control inventory, what you'll have to do is you'll have to play around with all these levers, and hence there is a advent of two-tier network in this supply chain.
Okay, interesting.
There will be different models.
I never thought about this business of breaking down a big box into small units. No, it didn't occur that something like that needs to be done. But yes, yeah. I can quite understand. Yes.
Yeah. So just since we are talking about inventory, and inventory is something I deal with, it's not only the MOQs which dictate this. It will also be function of your replenishment frequencies, right? So if I want to ask replenishment in all the three zones, I'll need a lot more inventory. Instead of that, I buy only in one zone. I'm buying only in Hyderabad. I can daily replenish my Madras and Cochin FCs. So the inventory required in these two FCs become very less. My variability on supply side are taken care only in Hyderabad, which can be a frequency of 7 days, 14 days, whatever maybe that number. But that number crashes down to 1 day for Madras and Cochin, because I'm going to have a daily truck running from Hyderabad to these two FCs. Right?
Okay.
So it's all about managing inventory. It's all balancing of working capital is what we are doing. And working capital is a critical thing. We'll talk about that when we talk about the data.
One question. So you did mention, so let's say that I'm a customer in Tirunelveli.
Yeah.
I order a phone. It's not available in the Chennai center.
Right.
You said it will get delivered from Hyderabad.
That's right.
Now, it could also be available in Cochin, but you will never send it to me from Cochin.
Correct. So that's a, again, nice question, because that's the simplicity I want to bring into my network. Right? Because what happens is when I'm talking about Tirunelveli, it's one example. Right? In South India, I will have at least, my guess will be around 3,000 odd pin codes. Right? And people from 3,000 odd pin codes are going to order. Right?
Yes.
Now, what it will mean is I will have to have a network in between. There has to be someone who is going from Chennai to Tirunelveli every day to deliver one of our orders in Tirunelveli. Right? Now, what I'm saying is a backup from Hyderabad. What is going to happen is Hyderabad order will be routed to Chennai, and Chennai person again is going to go to Tirunelveli and deliver that order. Right? Tomorrow, if I want to allow even Cochin to serve Tirunelveli, there will be additional person to go from Cochin to Tirunelveli.
Right.
I can do it for one pin code, but for thousands of pin code, it will just bloat up my cost.
Correct.
Right?
Correct.
And hence, to simplify this network, I will draw these lines.
Got it. And that's why you have drawn some of these orange lines there. Huh?
Correct. That's right.
Okay.
So the orange lines in this represent direct fulfillment from Hyderabad. So Hyderabad is serving all the customers. However, it's not going to go directly from Hyderabad to that pin code, right? A lot of drops in between. It's a hub and spoke model. So from Hyderabad, it will actually go to Chennai, and Chennai will deliver it to Tirunelveli.
Okay? Got it.
This is the simplest world that we are talking about. In case of, let's say I'm going back to my company, Flipkart, right? In case of Flipkart, we service 1% of all pin codes which are available in India. And we have around 19,000 civilian pin codes and plus military pin codes available, right? So it's a huge complex network. So typically we have a hub and spoke model where we have sorting centers, what we call mother hubs. Yeah. So the way the network will work is a customer will be attached to a delivery hub based on the pin code that customer belongs to. So each pin code will have one delivery hub attached. Now this delivery hub will have a mother hub attached. Multiple delivery hubs will be attached to a mother hub. And the mother hub will sort the deliveries for all the delivery hubs. And then from delivery hub, it will go to customer, right?
So this is a little bit like the postal service, huh?
It is postal service.
Okay. Right.
Thankfully, in India, we have the best postal service which we can think of. The pin code network, which is defined as fabulous. And we all ride on that.
Wonderful. Okay. Should I go to the next slide?
Yes, please. Right. So let's talk about the role play that we have, or the set of roles that we are going to talk about today, right? So we have Mr. Murthy, who is the MD and CEO of the company, who is responsible for overall well-being of this company, making sure that the company runs. And not only that, he is also responsible for making sure that the company sustains the expectations from growth, which are put up by the board, which in this case for FabMart will be expansion in pan-India geographies, as well as expansion beyond India, right? So Mr. Murthy is responsible for delivery of that. Then we have Mr. Shastri, who is head of planning, who is responsible for making sure the hygiene in the system is maintained, right? All the linkages have enough inventory and there are no stockouts. We are not buying too much of anything and not buying.
What is a stockout? Sorry to interrupt.
Yeah. All right, stockout. So stockout is a very bad thing in e-commerce where a customer wants to buy something and you don't have it. Right?
So customer is trying to order something.
Yes.
And so what should buy something? Unavailable. Right? Normally you see this thing saying unavailable, right?
Yes.
So that is called a stockout, huh?
That is a stockout situation. So we really don't want to go into stockout situation because that's a possibility of loss of customer.
Hmm.
Right? So one good thing about e-commerce is typically what we show is what we have. Rather, what we have is what we show. Right? So it's not like there is a random list. In offline, that might happen, right? A customer might walk into a store and ask for whatever brand, whatever model, or whatever SKU that he wants or she wants, right? Thankfully, in e-commerce, that happens and that doesn't happen because customer is still free to...
So you have to another jargon that you have introduced is SKU, Omkar.
Yes. Sorry, I'm using so many jargons in between. Yeah. So SKU is essentially a stock keeping unit. That is what a typical unit of picking and sale will be. So single mobile will become a SKU.
Okay.
The shirt will become a
SKU. So one brand of a mobile phone would be, like we said, Orange is a brand of mobile phone.
Yeah. So Orange will have, let's say, two or three different SKUs. I think we have a slide on that, Milan. Next.
Oh, okay. There will be more.
So there will be SKUs which are defined.
Okay.
So stock keeping unit is essentially a level at which we keep inventory.
Okay.
Yeah. So that is let's say Moto G fifth generation is a model.
Right. And an SKU, for an SKU, there will be a price, single price.
No. There is something in between also. The model is Moto G.
Okay.
Right. What converts it into SKUs is attributes.
Okay.
Right? Say Moto G fifth generation, red color, 8 GB RAM with 128 GB of ROM. That uniquely defines the product that a customer is buying. And hence, this will be attached to that particular SKU.
Okay.
The price could be similar for multiple SKUs because they are similar variants, like a color variant, right? A red color phone, a white color phone, a blue color phone will have all same price.
Oh, okay.
But they are different SKUs.
Okay. Understand.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that was SKU. So what we are talking about is the stockout situation, right? So customer might actually search for a particular phone. Again, Moto G fifth generation, red, 128 GB, 6 GB RAM. That may be a search criteria. And if customer searches for that search criteria, and if I don't have it, it's a stockout situation. I don't want to be there. How we will recover is exactly the way offline retail recovers, right? If you go to a shopkeeper and you ask for a particular thing, right? Let's say if you ask for, I want a Fevicol, right? The person will say, I don't have Fevicol, but look at this. There is a Camel gum, which is better than Fevicol, and it's cheaper. We want to buy it, right? That is what an offline shopkeeper will do. We do exactly the same thing. If the customer wants something, we don't have it, we'll push for something else. That is typically a rule of merchandising. So a missed SKU is not really a missed sale, thankfully, but it's an opportunity which we would have gained, which we are lost now. Right, so that's something that we fear about in e-commerce. Yeah.
So this is the job of Mr. Shastri.
So Mr. Shastri will have to ensure that all items that the customer is likely to buy are there for he or to buy. They are available in stock. That's what the job of Mr. Shastri is. Right. There is a additional complex to that. It should not be available. It should be available in right place. There will be uncertainties because of the demand. The demand might come in Madras. The demand might come in Chennai. In Coimbatore. It might come in Cochin. It might come in Hyderabad. I need to guess where the demand is going to come from. And I need to put inventory in the closest possible FC of the customer so that the customer is at best possible. Looks simple, but it is not.
Okay. I understand.
In this case, we will be talking about 30 different SKUs, if I'm right. If we handle close to 10 lakh SKUs.
In Flipkart, you know, 10 lakh SKUs.
Yeah.
Okay. And for this 10 case,
lakh active SKUs.
And we have simplified it to about 30 to just to get a few.
Yes. Yes. Okay. So 10 lakh SKUs, which are sold in last 1 month. Hmm. If I look at my store, I might have, let's say, 3x of that, which might be some SKUs which I'm yet to release. It might be new models. It might be old models which are there. So it's a big mad world out there.
So give you from a data science perspective, right? You can figure out now that beyond the point, Excel will not help you. Maybe 30 yes. SKUs you can manage with Excel, but if it is 10 lakh SKUs, then I don't think you can manage in Excel, no?
You need a database, you need software. You need to write Python scripts and so on. Yeah. Which is why in this course we are teaching everything. We are teaching that also. in this program.
So Python and R are our bread and butters.
Mm-hmm.
That is something we use daily, right? As Milin was saying, we will just not be able to do anything. Even Access, SQL, all of them are done, right? So just to just to have a little bit detour, if I remember, last year I attended some session on data, and they were talking about Flipkart generating something like 5 petabytes of data per day.
Per day?
Yeah.
By what? What is the unit?
Petabytes.
Which will be, you'll have to write the number of zeros. How many zeros is
it? Honestly, I don't know. I mean, that was the
I think it is 1 million gigabytes.
Okay.
No, 1 billion gigabytes.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh my.
Something like that. Some large number.
Very large number. Okay. Let's discuss Mr. Shah's role now.
Yeah. So Mr. Shah is a CFO, right? He is the one who says no in the system, right?
He's the one who says no. I see. Okay.
Right. He's the one who will not let anyone indulge for sake of customers, right? He's the one who will control the inventories. He's the one who will control the expansion. He's the one who will ensure that there is a return on investment on whatever, wherever we are investing money, right? Simplest way in which an e-commerce company can grow fast, just put the money and then just expand or buy additional, parallel companies and do a organic, inorganic expansion, right? But that is not always the best way. For a typical company to sustain and survive for, let's say, a long-term period, what is important is we ourselves are efficient. We are generating money from our own business so as to invest it back for my growth. I don't want investors' money to come in and fuel my growth. It's a good thing. Yes, I'm not saying it's a bad thing. But at the end of the day, when we are talking about sustenance of industry, sustenance of the company, it's important that I generate my own cash flows. I generate my own money and grow with that, right? So Mr. Shah's responsibility will be on that angle, and we'll see what kind of questions Mr. Shah will ask.
Okay, sure.
Let me go to the next slide. Yes. So here we are. The CEO has called for a meeting. The CEO has to make a presentation to board, and the board. And ask money for the board for expansion. And the board is going to expect n number of things. Board is going to expect all kind of data to take a decision on whether or not the company is ready for expansion in North India, right? So the CEO has to form a view and create a presentation on broadly the themes like how efficient is my network? Getting enough return on investment on the money that I'm flowing in right now or not? How is the revenue run rate? Am I growing in revenue or is it stagnant or is it falling? How is it moving? Right? How much is the inventory? How much I'm investing in my stocks? Right? Whether or not I'm making investment in the right locations or it's just random allocation of money which is happening. So how good I am at putting the money in inventory? Right? And doing all of these things for whom? For the final customer, right? And hence, we need to know whether or not what all of these SKUs that we are talking about are available to customer or not, or are there cases of stockouts? And if there are stockouts, what are we doing about that? What are the reasons that there are stockouts? And how do we ensure that the stockouts are at minimal possible level? How do we make sure the customers are happy? So that they will bring us more and more customers. So that is what we need to prepare our board meeting or prepare for our board meeting. And that's what the data should talk about from whatever is available in information. And that's what we need to prepare a CEO for this meeting.
Okay.